Good evening. Welcome to the Martin E. Segal Theater Center. My name is Antje Oegel. I'm Associate Director of Programs here at the Center. It's my pleasure to welcome you to a very special evening. We have all been looking forward to this very much. I don't know how many are familiar, with the Center's mission, which is to bridge academia and the professional theater. And part of that mission also is to honor, to remember great theater artists, artists that changed and challenged the theater of their times. Without a doubt, Spalding Gray belongs to this group. His work had a big impact when he was creating it on the theater scene and continues to have a big impact and influence on current and future, for sure, generations of theater makers. It has been a great day so far. We started early in the morning with screenings of films, documentations about Spalding Gray, documentations of his work. And tonight we will have discussions and reading, and we will show some film clips as well. So before we start, I would like to introduce and also thank our panel, Kathleen Russo, who is Spalding Gray's wife, and Lucy Sexton, who helped to put this event together here with us, and also Ken Kobland, the director of the film Ramsdale Road, which we presented today, as well as Clay Harpas, who is he in the audience today? I don't know.
He was here.
From the Worcester Group, he was really, he basically helped us get the rights to present Ramsdale Road. So please turn off your cell phones, and we will start with the trailer of Steven Soderbergh's film And Everything Is Going Fine. So we'll basically hand the mic to Spalding Gray himself first.
You know, maybe I should just tell you some of the facts as I remember them. They got very disillusioned with theater and the lack of adventure and experimentation. I just did a story of my day as fast as I could speak it. Joyce was running it after me. Who wrote it? I sat down at this table in front of whoever came. It was word of mouth, maybe there were 15 or 16 people there. And it was everything I could remember about sex and death until the age 14, which was the name of the monologue.
I was using myself to play myself. I was playing with myself.
And I was hooked. I was hooked. It went through me like a thump, like a whoop, like a you know what.
I kept a pretty tight diary for the facts, for the details.
My uncle said there are two kinds of people in Barrington Island, those who belong and those who don't. I'm discursive. I'm associative.
I couldn't spell. I couldn't write. I could barely read. I didn't know that had nothing to do with writing.
Suicide.
Shall I do it in the garage?
And the room is where she died of cancer. There was no mention of suicide.
Not dead, not killed herself. You know, you get it, that was avoidance language.
And everything is going fine, except for the squirrels, the gypsy moth, and a pig farmer named Rocky.
Swimming to Cambodia was a radical, and I've always been rooting for that breakthrough. You reached a larger audience, and I became more popular. I was told that I was manic depressive, was on clonopin and lithium. I didn't think I could do another monologue. Being a dad is fantastic, very grounding, and it's got me out of myself because, believe me, their needs are bigger than yours.
Forrest came to me very early on with questions about death. He wasn't even four. Everyone knows they're going to die, but no one really believes it.
I like telling the story of life better than I do living it. One of the ways to reincarnate is to tell your story. I get enormous pleasure from that. It's like coming back.
Well, I don't know if all of you have seen the film, but if not, it's really an amazing documentary. So I've seen it a few years back and just loved it. It really gives a great introduction into his work and into his life. So it was great. And you produced the film.
I produced it with two other people, yeah. Josh Blum and Amy Hobby.
Yeah. Well, I would love to start the evening with a question to all of you. So how did you get involved with Spalding Gray's work? How did you meet him?
I'll start because I have the least involved.
Oh, your mic's not on. I'll start because I have the least involvement.
I am a performer and a person who, you know, has been in the dance and performance scene, and I knew Spalding sideways through that, and, you know, was friends with other people in the Worcester group, not so much with Spalding. And I knew Kathy a little bit. And then about a year and a half after Spalding's death, Kathy was looking to put together a reading of his work for his what would have been his 65th birthday. And someone put us together as, you know, someone that I could help her do that. And then that grew into us sort of trying to create a whole piece out of, you know, Spalding's excerpts from his monologues, from his journals, etc. I mean, it was an extraordinary privilege to, like, all of a sudden be looking at, and, you know, all these journals and the shows and the texts, and it's amazing material. So then I worked on that with Kathy. So
that's, we worked on that for like a year before we even performed it, I think. Yeah. In my living room, she'd come out to Sag Harbor. We did like a whole storyboard from his journals. And that's when we got the idea that we didn't want one person retelling the story of Spalding, but make it into five characters, which you're going to hear a little bit pretty soon from that. How did you meet Spalding?
I met Spalding when I was in college in 1965.
In Schenectady, where I'm from.
In Schenectady. And he was a friend, boyfriend of Liz Lecompte's. I met Liz in college. Complicated, Skidmore Union, boys school, girls school, boys, girls, things like that. But it was also through an art teacher who basically we both admired, and I began to hang out with Liz, and we hung out together, and then she came to the city one summer, I think it was 66, rented a sublet an apartment on Tompkins Square Park, and one day Spalding arrived, and I met him for the first time, and he seemed very aloof and mysterious and unreachable in a funny way, and I was very impressed with him. and thought, well, he's a real man, he's a real guy, Liz and Spald began to work. After Spald, of course, joined the performance group under Richard Schechter in the early 70s, and then Liz also joined the group, and they began to work together and do performance pieces of their own, and essentially became what the performance group evolved into, which is the Worcester group. And I was making films at the time, or starting to make films at the time, and at that point, I was working with them and putting films, and before video, using film, that they would use, making films with them that they would use in the performances, that they would project or use somehow in the performances, or that would play out in some another text. We always thought of it, oh, let's put another film in here and have another text, a level of textual text, whatever, and visual text. And that was the end of it, or the beginning of it, and we became very close, and that was it. And then life goes on, and then we wind up like this, I suppose.
And I met Spalding in 1990 in Rochester, New York, where I was working at a theater, and my boss had asked Spalding if he wanted to come up to Rochester to perform his recent monologue, which was Monster in a Box then. And I picked him up at the airport, and then we were together until he died in 2004. But not together. I mean, it was a very rocky relationship to get to a point where we were in a relationship and having a family and children. And we had two boys. I had a daughter who was three when we first met, and he really was like a dad to her as well. So, and we have two boys who are now 19, 23, and my daughter's almost 30.
Maybe we can talk a little bit about the tradition and about his beginnings and how this all started for him, how he got into theater, and, you know, what was the tradition that he came out of?
Well, one thing I want to say is that he was told when he was a boy, in high school that he was, he was dyslexic, but they didn't really know what that was then, that he was backwards. So he didn't have a lot of confidence about what he was going to do after he graduated high school. He knew he wanted to go to college, but he didn't have a lot of confidence or a clear idea of what he wanted to do. And then it was in the theater in Texas, right, that he found his voice, or... he went to Emerson. First BU, right? Or BC, Boston College. And then he went to Emerson. And that's where he sort of got the acting bug and found his voice. But there was one particular moment where someone said, told him, I thought it was in Texas, that you can really tell a story. Do you remember reading that anywhere?
Well, it's the Alley Theater in Houston is where he goes. He thinks he's going to be an actor, and so he tries to take acting jobs. And I think the Alley is where he gets frustrated with
acting.
acting in other people's stuff, and and he wants to have more of his own voice.
He was the way, again, he was, because Skidmore, where Liz went to school, was a all-girls school. When they did productions, they had to hire men for the productions. So he had gone up to Saratoga, and he was basically performing in the theater, which is how he met Liz. There was also a wonderful kind of coffee shop called Cafe Lena, which was a kind of a pit stop on the way between Boston and New York. All the kind of great folk heroes, besides Dylan and the McGarrigle sisters and Dave Van Ronk and blah blah blah, would basically perform there. And there was a little theater company there, and which he tells the stories about in his monologues. Eventually, his early monologues, he tells these stories about performing. In fact, I don't know if you want to show it now.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay. In fact, I have after Rumstick Road, which was three pieces that he and Liz did with the Worcester Group, as the Worcester Group, and one of them, the first one was Siconic Point, and that was a kind of nonverbal piece in which they were just kind of a dance piece, very small, very few people, and just a beautiful kind of choreography of dances, but dance movements, very simple. Hardly dance, more like walking around. Mm-hmm. Then came Rumstick Road, which is the biography or the telling of a story about his mother's and his mother's death, his mother's suicide. After Rumstick Road comes Nay at School, and in Nay at School, which you're about to see a section, a very, very small part of, he sits down at a table, at a long table with two other people, has a glass of water and a record player, which is the record player you saw in the Steven Soderbergh clip, and he begins to tell the story of how he first did the T.S. Eliot play, The Cocktail Party, and that was done at this Cafe Lena in Saratoga sometime in the 60s. And this was the first time he really sat down and talked directly to the audience. The audience is sitting about at the end of this table, and he is talking across to them and basically ad-libbing and telling the story while he plays the record of The Cocktail Party. And just to get, we're now starting this third production or whatever it's called, with this third recreation, like Rumstick, in which we're going to try to rebuild, re-put together some sense of what this theater experience was like. And what you'll see is a three-minute introduction to it, essentially, which kind of just tries to sort out or show the space of the theater, the levels on which it was performed. It was very complicated. The audience sat very high up, looked down into a pit in which the actors performed in the, so to speak, pit, which was the bottom of the stage or the bottom of the theater. And also, but it began with this long table in front of the audience directly in the stands. So if we can play that, this is very crude. It's literally just out of the nothing. It's actually
raw.
That's the stands, that's the house, and the red tent, which appears constantly or repeatedly in all of these pieces. So the audience would go up the stairs and take a seat in these stands. And here was the long table. And at the table was Spalding, that's Ron Voda, and forget her name, I'm sorry. Thank you. It wasn't Joan yet. So this is the setup, and that's basically Spalding's position there in the center. That's, who is that? Someone I know or knew. And they would also perform in that. That was a film I made that they used in the piece, projected in the center of the stage. And then, once again, and that's again the original setup. Spald played the doctor, Dr. Harko, or something. Many things were performed in this box. That's Ron Vorta, Libby House, Spalding. Essentially a kind of mad scientist. The audience is sitting in the stands. And Spald is playing the record. I got exposed to the cocktail party when John Wynne Evans, who was running the theater, crazy man, relatively theater person, he ran the theater for the Cafe Lena, and as Spalding's about to describe, which is kind of funny, maybe I shouldn't have turned it off, but he's saying, well, we would just sit around and say, what should we do? And someone would say, well, how about the cocktail party? And someone would say, yes, let's do the cocktail party. And anyway, so that basically is the origins, as far as I can tell, of the first time he sat down at a table.
Yeah, I've never seen that before.
So are you working on that film?
Yes, we're going to try to do what we did with the rum stick, which is try to put it together. It's a bit of an archaeological dig, because there's very little stuff is left. The soundtrack is terrible. It was shot, this was a piece that we have some video footage, black and white, but it's the kind of footage where the ghost, the face is...
It looks like a hologram almost.
It might have to be a hologram. And so one of the theories is, well, okay, maybe people will fill in some of it. I was going to ask Kathy if Theo sounds like Spalding enough.
Yeah.
Okay.
That would be cool.
because it's...
Keep it in the family.
Yeah. And so that someone may read it and other people may perform it. It's pretty madcap, so it's not necessarily, I don't think it's going to like interfere with the play that much, but anyway, it's tough to bring this stuff back. It's hard. Even if it's well photographed or well shot, it's just, you know, it's who wants to watch a play on screen in a way? I mean, that's always a problem. Mm-hmm. That's all we have. It's like seeing art in a, but okay.
Well, but Rumstick Road is a really beautiful documentation of the work, and
right.
I think also pretty successful. I mean, there's really an interest. I remember seeing it done at the archaeological, film archives. And it was packed.
Yeah,
so
it was great.
There's really an interest in Spalding Gray's, in the Worcester Group's work. So where did it go from there? So those were the beginnings, and then how did he actually end up solo performing?
They did a couple of other plays, but then he started to work on his own. So that while they were doing, I think the next thing was Point Judith or something. Another name, all of these names, Point Judith, Rumstick, are all his biography names, the places he grew up, the streets he grew up on. They did Point Judith, and but then he started. He did this first piece, I think, Sex and Death.
Sex and Death, 14.
That's when he began to
find his voice.
Find his voice, and basically step out of the plays, and gradually over the few years, he stepped out of the plays far enough that he wasn't in the plays anymore.
And that was really. I mean, he told me I wasn't in a relationship within them, but he told me it was really hard to leave the safety of the Worcester group because that was like his safety net. In a way, it was very. His comfort zone to go out there by himself and do 90 minutes of a monologue with just him and a glass of water and a desk and a microphone.
Much more exposed, at that point, rather, I don't know, does one say radical or at least risky in the sense that, you know, I mean, it's doing monologues now is not necessarily so, you know, unusual.
He's the grandfather.
He's definitely the grandfather, if not the something. What's the better?
But there was one thing that Spalding used to say about monologues. I always like to share with the audiences. He goes, everyone thought they knew him, that he was telling them everything about his life or that period that he was talking about in the monologue. He goes, well, the monologue's 90 minutes, and, you know, I'm 50-something years old. There's a lot more there that people don't know. But I always liked that, you know, quote from him.
I always found it really interesting because Spalding talks in some of the intros to his books and in some of the journals talks about his process of writing, which was not to write, which was to perform them, so that he would perform the monologue and record it on an audio recording, and listen to it that night, and then he would make I should do that, and he wouldn't write it down. He would do it again the next night and say the story in a different way and record that and then go back and listen to that. He tells a great story about. When the New York Times magazine asked him to write, one of those interesting one-page, back-page stories.
No, they were putting him on the cover.
They asked him to write a piece. And he said, well, I don't write. And they said, yeah, that's funny, but go ahead, you write a piece for us. And he said, no, really, I don't write. And he said, finally, he asked, and maybe it was you, Ken, but he asked a friend to come over and sit down across the desk from him, and he would tell the story and record it, and that's how he... And then he had somebody transcribe it, and that's what he gave to the Times. But he's, you know, even in that trailer, he talks about, you know, he can't write, I can't spell, I can't, you know. But I like this way of figuring out what the story is by telling it and revising it and telling it and revising it.
And he hated writing, I mean, but he would make himself write in his journal every morning with his coffee. And that would be really about it for the writing. And he never typed. He never used a computer. It was all longhand in his marble journals, almost every day.
And how did he write his novel?
he didn't have a hand after. But he had to give it to a transcriber. And she, I mean, his penmanship was pretty easy to read then. Yeah. Yeah.
Like a, you know, good 12-year-old.
Yeah. He was a good transcriber in Queens.
Well, that's the whole story is of Monster in a Box. Yeah. This impossibility of writing this thing, which keeps getting longer, and he keeps trying to avoid it, and it keeps going, and it's, you know, it's a real challenge for him to write a novel.
Yeah, very true. I heard once in an interview, I heard him say that he's, and that sort of, you know, feeds what you were saying, that he is dancing with the audience, which is something that I find is a very nice phrase, which sort of also counters the way he presented the work, sitting still and not moving. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, that's also something. How did that the storytelling by, you know, the one person show that's not moving around in the space, but actually being still, sitting still. What was the whole impetus behind that? Can anyone talk about that?
He just like it worked the first time. I think why change is what he thought. I don't know. That's what I always thought. Yeah. It was like his brand, you know what I mean? Like before that word was popular, it was like, because this is what I do and this is how it works for me for future monologues. Mm-hmm. And then he would try to break out of it a little bit. He did this thing called interviewing the audience, which I loved. And he would go and say you were all in the lobby before the show, and he would just go up to people he thought might be, he could have a good conversation with, write down their name on an index card, take like 30 names, go backstage, and pick out, I don't know, like five of them, and then call them up on stage to have just a simple conversation. He would always start it out with the first question would be, how did you get here tonight? And then it would go to, you know, this conversation. And it was amazing how it worked, because you think, that could really flop. But he had a great interviewing skill. He could make, you know, boring stories seem, you know, exciting. So he did try to do other little things, you know, off from the monologue.
I also think, I mean, that thing about just telling the story, that's what he's fascinated with, right? That's what he writes about a lot and talks about a lot even in that opening, is, you know, that it's the story of what happened. And I know with interviewing the audience, people always said afterwards, oh, well, you set that up. You knew what they were going to say, but he didn't, right? So it's this interest and an extraordinary gift for taking the stories of ordinary life, right? Morning, noon, and night is like a day in the life of a family, right? You wake up and there's nothing extraordinary happens in this day, but it's a fantastic story, and he weaves it into a fantastic story, and he tells it as such a fantastic story. But it's, I think it's partly taking that material. And
yeah. And his great gift, aside from the monologues too, is that he paid attention to the details. So that really helped with his storytelling.
Maybe I'm reminded of something. At one point, living on 93rd Street,
mm-hmm.
and he was working at the American Place Theater, which was on 70s, in the 70s mm-hmm. somewhere, and he was doing plays. They did traditional plays, sort of, I don't know, Endicott and the Red Cross, something, mm-hmm. I remember that, and something else about the Gates of Death or something. And but he would come back with a couple of, I was homeless, so to speak, at the time. I was sleeping on the floor of that place. And that was Liz and his place. And and he would come back with a couple of pale ales, India pale ales.
After the show. Yeah, uh-huh.
He'd walk home from 77th to 93rd, and he would come back with stories of the day that just had us crying. We're just on the floor weeping,
right.
And we thought, you know, it was one of those things where you say, "Oh man, you got to tell somebody this shit because this is really great," you know. And you think, "No, don't spoil it, you know. Don't make it a performance
a
piece,
public
piece." You know, you know, it's funny. I have a little bit of a different feeling about the interviewing the audience.
Mm.
Okay, I think Spalding was pretty much. He wasn't honestly interested in other people. I know that.
Oh, I disagree with you completely.
Okay. I think he used that. I think he used them to make his own stories, to build a story of his making. And so that I think other people's stories interfered with him.
He used to say, he goes, you know, everyone has a story to tell. They just have to learn how to tell it well. So he would get them on stage to tell it well, is how I felt.
They'd be competing with him. He didn't want that.
He did have some competition.
Well, eventually, yeah, absolutely, because everyone was trying to outperform him.
I mean, people getting up there.
Oh, yeah, that's what I mean. Yeah, they would say, oh, you want to hear a story? And they, you know, they intentionally want to get him on his knees, you know.
Well, maybe before we have the reading, an excerpt from the play Stories Left to Tell. I would quickly love to ask the two of you, mm-hmm. how did it all come about? Did you decide that you wanted to create this piece?
Well, the first thing, like after Spalding died, and I started to go through his journals, and I realized there was like all this enormous documentation from his journals and film clips and everything, and I just really wanted to do everything I could possibly think of, or with the assistance from friends and other people, think of projects that would keep his legacy going. And so he wasn't just remembered, you know, for the act of suicide, that his work still kept going on after he died. And so the first thing was, I was approached by PS122, like Lucy said, and we were gonna do some sort of tribute. And so you heard the story about how we realized that we actually could do a play out of the material that we had. And it was a year of like dissecting his journals to make this arc of his life. And
again, same thing. It was a year of doing like maybe once a month read-throughs with
mm-hmm.
different people and see, you know, oh, did we get enough of that information? Oh, that story's
too long.
Trying
different actors, yeah.
I would also say just to, and tell me if I'm wrong, but one of the reasons you have this idea is that Spalding's memorial a couple of people did, I know Kate Valk and a few other people read some of Spalding's stories.
That was at readings. The Kate Valk was at Swimming to Cambodia at Barnes & Noble. Yeah, that was one of the light bulb moments. So, okay. Yeah,
and the light bulb is really like, can other people read Spalding's words?
Right.
And that's something that certainly we got a lot of hesitation and pushback from people, like, you know, it's all about Spalding. And I think one of the great things for me is that I'm not saying that, you know, we wouldn't all love to just be watching Spalding tell these stories, for sure, but it underlined what good writing it was, that it was theatrical writing, that someone else could take it and do it this way and that way, and, you know, it had some flexibility to it, like any play does, so that it could be taken on by other voices.
I have a question. Did the readings change? I mean, did you change the what was read each performance, or no?
Well, not once it was up on Minetta Lane.
In the development time.
In the development time,
yeah.
When
we were doing the readings at Bowery Poetry Project.
Okay.
CBGB's, we did a reading.
Right, and that was, I remember that. And, okay.
So it was just to figure out
what pieces you're going to use. Yes.
What worked, kind of like, you know, how Spalding worked.
Right.
What felt flat and what worked.
Once you said it, you kept it, and people would read, different people would read the same text.
And we tried to really contrast it, like, you know, we had a female actress read some of the sex scenes, you know, or something, just, you know, as if she was the male. We tried to, you know, contrast the character, the actors, with the material as much as possible.
So, back before, what was his first piece that was like sitting at a table with
Sex and Death?
Sex and Death.
Mm-hmm.
And that was what year?
Oh, before my time.
No,
79,
possibly.
And then it premiered at the Minetta Lane Theater in, when was this?
We were just trying to remember
2007.
The exact date.
Minetta Lane is 2007. Yeah. Yeah. We work on it for a couple of years at different iterations. And then
we toured it around the country for a year after that, after it closed at Minetta Lane.
Where is it now?
Mm. Dramatic Publishing owns the rights to it, so anyone can perform it. If they want to
really?
Buy it, yeah. And, I mean, you know, pay the royalty fee. And we would, I mean, Lucy, both of us, I can say for sure, would love to remount it at some point.
Yeah, but I also thought, you know, the thing that I wish I had the capacity to advertise or get out is I always feel like it should be a perfect thing for universities,
mm-hmm.
right? It's five different people. There are all these juicy monologues. You can do it with any set or no set. And I would love it. That would be my dream of it. So that other generation gets to know these stories and the work.
Yeah. So so we will have a brief excerpt from the piece, and afterwards we will have a Q&A with the audience.
I should say that the piece as it, you guys can stay there.
Oh, we can stay.
Oh, you want to go sit? Okay.
That's right.
That the piece basically tries to, in a sort of collage way, take you through the arc of his life, and the piece itself is 90 minutes. This is 15 minutes, but so you're going to get a very abbreviated little, you know, excerpts from different parts of Spalding's life and his work.
Journal entry 1978. The furthest back that I can remember is Mom feeding me in my wooden high chair. When I wouldn't eat, she'd start rapping out the opening to Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, da-da-da-da, and say, that's fate knocking. Now, I wouldn't say that's exactly a performance, but it was something more abstract than eat your food, dear, or think of the starving Koreans, which was, in fact, a line my mother used to incorporate around the time of the Korean War. I still think of it. It was always hard to imagine those starving Koreans, and even harder now that there are Korean delis on every corner.
I was bored with life. I know I shouldn't have been. I know I should be thankful. But it was flat. It was just a flat thing. And I would keep hyping it up with this kind of acting out. For instance, 4th of July, some fireworks go off outside. I'm just a kid. The little lady fingers go pop, 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 pop. So I run to the window and I say, Mom, come quick. Ross Jamin, our neighbor's up on the roof shooting his kids. Now, this was in the old days, when that wasn't done so often. And my mother would rush to the window, believing it. And she would go, Oh, Spuddy, dear. No, 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 no. Now, why do you have to do this?
That summer, the bay was clear with no algae. We could see all the way down to the bottom as we swam, and Mom and I would swim together. If I couldn't see everywhere in all directions at once, which was, of course, impossible, I would go into a sort of panic. She was a good, relaxed swimmer, as if she belonged to the bay. Mom never noticed my panic. She swam strong and fearless ahead of me. Then we'd dry off in the sun and eat lunch together, side by side. Mom always had something simple for lunch, like a glass of milk and a tuna fish sandwich on Pepperidge Farm white bread. But I really wanted to fly the nest. A big part of me wanted to get out of there. I wanted so to go to Bali, or at least to Provincetown. I wanted to go to Provincetown and, I don't know, get in trouble, maybe even fall in love, whatever that was. I needed to get away from Mom. It was too sticky and warm to be right. So in the morning, I'd load up Mom's big tin bread box Ford with all the goodies I felt I needed to survive on the beach in Provincetown. L.L. Bean sleeping bag, Mom's Metrical and instant breakfast. I'd go and say goodbye to Mom and head out for Provincetown. A few blocks from home, I'd end up turning around and heading back, unloading the car and swimming and eating lunch with Mom on the lawn. One last swim, one last lunch. The next day, I'd load up the car again, and with my sleeping bag, Mom's Metrical, and instant breakfast, I'd drive a few miles farther, and then just end up turning around and coming back. Mom never asked me why I kept coming back. We'd just swim and eat lunch together and sit there on the edge of Narragansett Bay. I never made it to Provincetown that summer.
Journal entry 1982. The unobserved life doesn't feel like living. Once I no longer felt God watching, I began to watch myself. I have found that I like the fact that I have been writing every day. I have been writing as though I was up against a deadline. And as I write now, I feel that good writing could help you to write your way out of almost anything. I think of myself as a collage, taking bits and scraps from the growing heap of my life in order to create a more conscious narrative form. I came to know of my life through the telling of it.
I went out, and it was winter in Minneapolis. A group of us, I think there were probably 17 of us, men and women, did this incredible ceremony that Azaria Thornbird led with the peace pipe, where she called all the Indian spirits from all four directions. We were all inside a tent, sitting naked in a circle on straw, which is laid over the snow. It's dark and it's cold in there because no hot rocks have been brought in yet. Azaria instructs us that the sweat ceremony could last a long time, 2 or 3 hours. Toward the end of the prayers, we'd pray to give something away, some condition that we no longer wanted. But she warns us, in no case, should we identify with what another person gives away. Because if we take it on, we're going to be in trouble. So just pass it on, don't identify with it, just pass it on, let it go out of the tent. After that, she will come and pour cold water over the rocks. And we're supposed to sit in silence and listen to the hot rocks steam. And they often actually speak and give us valuable information. That's what Azaria told us, sorry. I like this very much, this whole very ritualized ceremony. I like it. I just hope that people don't go on. I mean, there are 17 people in there, and after all, and I hope their prayers aren't too long because it's going to get real hot. People begin praying. Oh, great spirit, this is Robert speaking. I want to remain humble and get rid of my macho qualities for this ceremony. I have spoken. It comes around to me, and I say, oh, great spirit, this is Spalding speaking, and I pray that I can maintain a sincere and open attitude in this ceremony and not pollute it with my heady analysis and ironic commentary and end up just turning this sacred event into just another story that I will try to sell to the American public. And the entire tent goes, ho, 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 which is kind of a supportive cheer to say, let's see if you can pull that one off. More hot rocks are brought in. Now, it's starting to get a little hot. Oh man, I know what they mean by sweat. And my God, I've got my nose down on the ground and I'm trying to breathe in fresh air from under the bottom of the tent. And all I can see is that sign on the outside of the steam bath at my health club in New York City that says, do not exceed 15 minutes under any circumstances. And I'm thinking, who is this Azaria Thornbird anyway? How long have I been in here? What's going on? More hot rocks are brought in, lots. Now the place is really hot. The place is reeking. People are down on their sides, they're choking, they can't breathe. My pulse is up to 160. Another round of prayer starts. We're supposed to give something away. I can't wait to pray. I'm telling you, I feel like my heart is going to explode. I've got my hand on my pulse. It's so hot, I can't breathe, and people are praying. Outbreak spirit, this is Susan speaking. I want to give away my gluttony, I have spoken. It comes around to me. I say, oh, great spirit, this is Spalding speaking, and I want to give away the fear that I am about to have a heart attack at this very moment. And just as I say this, the guy next to me, who is about my age, leaps up and he runs out of the tent screaming, my heart is popping, my heart is popping, my heart is popping. And I'm fine. My pulse slows down. He has just taken all my fear and run right out the door with it. Azaria says, someone has broken the sacred circle here. The power has gone out of the sweat. Now listen, we're gonna do the fourth round of prayers where we'll listen to the rocks talk. And if any of you feels you have to go, you must leave now. Because when this flap shuts, you're in. Oh my. Now, I at the same time am very claustrophobic and find it difficult to take orders. But I am determined to ride this thing out. I sit hard and I just hope that the hot rocks don't take too long, you know? She says, I'm closing the flaps. She closes it. And this guy, who's a member of the lodge with a ponytail down to his ass, leaps up and charges for the flap. She throws her naked body in front of him and says, get back, lame deer, get back! He hurls himself back on the hay, crying, shit, fuck, fuck, fuck! Everyone is holding him down and chanting, ho, 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 ho. Everyone's ho-hoing him, ho-hoing him, ho-hoing him, until at last he's calm. We sit there, panting, and we listen to the hot rocks talk. I didn't understand a word.
Journal entry 1992. I went to a Chinese deli to buy water, and when I walked out, I had a very blissful moment. Could almost call it a perfect moment. I watched a fast-blowing cloud break up and go through the most extreme colors of turquoise to magenta. I felt suddenly free and open and not in need. For me, the bubbles are often perfect moments that lift me out of my sadness and despair. I can't be creative without being self-destructive because I'm like Humpty Dumpty. There are two me's deeply built in, the smasher and the rebuilder. I am both Humpty and the King's man. I am both lost and found.
When I was in therapy about 2 years ago, one day I noticed that I hadn't had any children. And I like children at a distance. I wondered if I'd like them up close. And I wondered why I didn't have any. I guess I'd always fantasized that if and when I had a child, it would be in Northern California. We, me and some sweet hippie beauty I was living with, would have a water birth. Or the child would be brought into the world by a midwife in a teepee somewhere. I always thought that one day it would all at last happen to me in Northern California. In fact, I had begun to define my life as what I did waiting to move to Northern California.
I wanted to see my son. After all, I'd never seen him, and now he was 8 months old. I was completely unaware that this was a long time. I was under the impression that once a baby, always a baby. I guess I thought of 6 years old as the end of babyhood. I had no idea that 8 months was quite a way along in the development of a child. I called Kathy and went to see them. She woke the baby, lifted him out of the crib, and he went straight for her breast. When I saw that, I knew there was no need for a blood test. I saw the back of my father's head and his head. I saw my brother Rocky's eyes. I saw a distant mirror. I saw a little lust flower. I saw a glorious accident. I saw a completely formed whole human being, and I experienced a perfect paradox at that moment. I knew now that I could die and that I had to stay alive to help this little guy through. Kathy had a radical plan. She said, you haven't seen him for 8 months. You should go bond with him. Take him off alone to your summer house in the country. And I did. I thought it was a completely mad idea, but I didn't question it. I was on the train to Brewster North with this 8-month-old creature who was in my arms. I assumed he was beautiful because everyone on the train kept stopping to say, "Oh my goodness, what a lovely granddaughter you have." When I got to the house, I put him on the floor like a rug rat, a hamster, a cat, or a dog. Let him do his thing while I do my thing. Get out the Bloody Mary mix, the salmon, the green peas, and prepare dinner. And then I had to change his diaper. Bending over him, I looked down into his eyes, and I fell in. I did not expect the gaze that came back. It was absolutely forever. Long, pure, empty, not innocent, because way beyond innocence, mere being, pure consciousness. The observing self that I'd always been trying to catch was staring back at me. They were no agenda eyes. Clear, open, not blinking, not judging, not tempting, not needing, not hurting, not consoling, just pure. Not old, not new, because not in time. And I just stared until I blinked. I had to pull away. I couldn't go on anymore in there. I took him in my arms and we were together for 5 hours. He ate with me in my lap, and when I chewed my green peas, he reached into my mouth and took them to feed himself. I got the image of a mother bird, mother robin, the way they spit the food into their baby's mouths. So I took his little head, and holding it, I went to spit the green peas into his mouth like a mother bird. And he gave me a straight arm. And I thought, my God, he's got boundaries. Where would he get them at 8 months? I could learn something from him. His dad doesn't have them at 52.
Journal entry, 1997. Forrest used to come up to me and say, "Dad, tell me a scary story." And I, who am really not very good at making up stories, said, "Look around you. This is the scary story." But what I don't add and should is that it's also a story about wonder and boredom and self-pity, dreck, transcendence, and love. I think I shut my heart down to protect myself from Mom's sadness, but the children opened my heart. They have been a blessing, and these memories burn in my heart like religious icons. A, Marissa toasting me on my birthday for bringing her brother Forrest into the world. B, me and Forrest on the way to Martha's Vineyard in that old Ford Escort, and when I was so hot and lost outside Providence, Forrest, who was sleeping in his car seat beside me, woke and kissed me. See, and most certain by Theo's face at birth and the honest confusion it expressed. I just looked down at him and saw this big, "Why?" expression coming back at me. He seemed to be asking me, "Why this? Why something and not nothing?" Oh, children. The most any of us can hope for is to inhabit a few graceful moments in time and to recognize them as such. The rest is an unsolved mystery.
That was really great. How many of you have seen the production of this play? So not that many. Maybe a very brief question. How was it directed? How was it produced? How did it look like?
Director. When we did stage it, I mean, when we would do the readings, we were often just all sitting, you know, and sometimes we would put the journal reader in the sort of classic Spalding look. And we kept that for the production, but the rest of it was just, sort of a stage with a couple of levels, and people would move around and sometimes stand and tell their story and sometimes sit, but simple movement and then just stop and tell your story. The backdrop of the set, which was very lovely,
it's beautiful.
Was we just Xeroxed pages from his journals, so his own writing, and that just hung in, you know, it's like a formed a psych.
High, as high
you
as
couldn't
that,
see any
yeah.
of the writing, but it was, you know, you could tell that it was sort of so.
Very simple, like you would have wanted it, yeah.
Okay, so I would like to open the forum. We're also recording all of our events, so when you have a question, someone will give you a mic, and please use it, because we're recording that. So, okay.
So we have to Yu Chen, maybe with the mic. Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have one question right there.
Yes. How much, if any, were his monologues spur of the moment created, or were they? If he did one, if he did the monologue one day, the next day was the same words, or did he improvise?
Well, the monologues, most of them were created from some kind of crisis he was going through in his life. So he would go, when he had an idea, like, for example, Grey's Anatomy was about really about his eye surgery, because he was losing the eyesight in one eye. And he would go back maybe a year or two from his monologues and start making an outline. And that's what that was the key for him, was an outline with all the key events that happened that was going to create the arc of this monologue. And then we talked about earlier how he would go to like a small theater like this, like a PS-122 with 100 people, and then he'd listen to the audio tape and cut and edit that way. And then it would be maybe a year later, he'd bring it to Lincoln Center and he would perform it there and then tour it around the country.
They would become set, so that once he had it where he wanted it, it was the same every night.
And he wrote in his journal every day.
Every day.
And so he had a kind of internal monologue going pretty much all the time. And so as it would kind of shape out, he would basically, you know, work off of that material.
And when you saw him on stage, you would see he'd come out with a notebook.
Yeah.
But it was just an outline. There was nothing. He wasn't really reading.
Right. To remind
him
of what he's supposed to think about.
And from what I can recall, I don't think he ever lost his place. You know, he would improvise a little bit here and there, but he would always do it almost the same every night.
Wow, I'm just overwhelmed, speechless in some ways. Mm-hmm. Thank you, and that was wonderful. A couple of things that come to mind in a question. I keep on hearing Gene Shepherd. I grew up with Gene Shepherd. Mm-hmm. I'm about the same age as Spalding, and I can just hear Gene Shepherd come to life, and I just love it. And you know, I used to believe that I would see go and turn on televisions and hear Gene Shepherd on Channel 9 with the television blank. It would just be black. It would be no image, and you'd just listen in the early days. The other thing I hear is when you mentioned that he hid himself away until his children came, and I hear that as a father, who's I'm actually a documentary filmmaker looking at doing a documentary on for new fathers, because they have no idea what's going on, and I hear in your voice and his what the love and how he just kind of blossomed out as a, you know, came into his own, and
he really didn't. He obviously didn't plan on becoming a father. There was no planning there. And when we first met, he said, "I have no interest in having children of my own." And it was maybe 6 months after I had met him, and he was doing this project at the 52nd Street Project, where they worked with kids from the inner city and put on plays with them, or monologues in his case. And I looked at him afterwards. I said, "You're going to be a dad. You're so good with children." He goes, "Don't say those words to me." You know, like he was really afraid of it. He was really afraid of becoming a father, I think.
Sorry.
Did
you want to say?
I met Spalding at the 1984 Olympics, where he did Sex in Cars. And I told him my story, amongst other things. and I've met him a few times along the way. The question is, mental illness, and how that played a role into everything he did, including his relationship with you and his children. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Well, yeah. I mean, he was definitely prone to depression, and he struggled with his mother's suicide. It was, I mean, it's really dominant in most every monologue he, you know, did. And he struggled with that his whole life, his mother's mental illness. And he really did try to not repeat, you know, what was her ultimate fate. Something that I think this man here earlier, right? You were here earlier, we were talking about it. He did, a lot of people don't realize, like, at the end, he had brain damage from our car accident in Ireland. And Oliver Sacks was his doctor. And beautifully wrote an article last year before he died in the New Yorker that explained Spalding's case and everything. So I honestly don't think he killed himself because of mental illness, even though he was prone to it. I really do believe that he had brain damage, and that's what ultimately made him, you know, kill himself. It's post-traumatic stress, and, you know, as we're seeing more and more of today, from vets and football players and, you know, car accidents.
I just, one thing about children and Spalding. Oddly enough, in Rumstick Road, there are four children. Nayett School. Thank you. Sorry. In Nayett School, which... Thanks, ma'am. In Nayett School, there are four children. And the children play the roles in the cocktail party that that Spall's talking about performing, that they're going to go down into the space and perform. Nayett School would be a very difficult thing to do these days, because the children were, for all practical purposes, kind of used and abused in a way. They were picked up and moved around. They all smoked cigarettes.
Right.
they were lighting the kids' cigarette all the time. They were passing out on the floor and being dragged around or shook in the air. Quite mad. But this involvement with these children was also a kind of surrogate play of Spalding's, and he got very close to them. They were very, they're lovely.
And stayed in touch.
They're still,
I remember.
Yeah. Right. There were four of them. One has died of cancer at this point, but the other kids have survived relatively well. I mean, obviously their parents were kind of loony to let them go into this thing and perform in this way. And so it would be something that wouldn't happen today. They'd be closed down. But it was an interesting thing that it was so much involved with children.
But that you observed that.
And that, in fact, there's the next piece is, I think Michael Rifkin is in the next piece, Point Judith, and he performs. And there's a lot of embracing of the children in it, a lot of physical, you know, contact. He holds them and he hugs them and he carries them around. And it's really another otherworldly piece. It's quite beautiful, but it's also interesting in the sense of the childless, anti-child father, so to speak.
And he was a really terrific dad. He was a really giving, generous father.
The thing about the accident, too, which is it played out in a way that fulfilled his worst fears,
right.
You know. Because at one point he said, in one of the monologues, I forget, he said something, what could make me do that? What weird thing could make me do what my mother did? Staggering how life can just do exactly what you plan or didn't plan. Anyway, that's...
Hold on one second.
He was 26. I'm going to make you say it in the microphone. Hold on one second.
We need the mic. How old was he when his mother committed suicide?
Around 26.
He was a grown man, actually.
Oh, he was.
Was he close with her?
But from the time he was like 10 on, she had been in and out of institutions.
Oh, she was.
In and out of
like
hospitals.
He grew up with that.
Yeah. She was.
She was mentally ill on and off.
Yes. She was institutionalized a number of times with suicide issues. And
she had electric shock.
And she was a Christian Scientist. And that's, he grew up with a family of, his mother was a Christian Scientist.
Must have been very hard for him. As a son growing up, a mother's even to a daughter, is very important, you know. Not having her as a whole person, you know.
Well,
there's this, it's in the movie that Steven did, but right. There's this one point where he's coming home from college, and she asked him, she goes, how should I do it, Spud? Mm. How should I do it? Yeah. Should I do it in the car? Should I do it in the water?
She was also the time, yeah, chronic, yeah.
So it was a big burden for him,
yeah,
growing up,
terrible.
With, as it was for his other brothers, too.
Terrible, very.
And then he was away.
Right.
He was in Mexico when she killed herself. He didn't find out for, what, a month?
When he came back. Yeah, he came back.
The novel that he's trying to write is called Impossible Vacation, because he finds that he can never go on another vacation, because one time he goes on vacation, he comes back and finds out that his mother has killed herself.
See, those kind of people, from what I know about mental illness, and reading about it, is that they're chronic. Eventually, they're going to do it. They're going to succeed, you know?
Right, but that's why I think it's really important that everyone here knows, too, that he did have mental illness, but it was the brain damage, I believe, that, you know, made him kill himself.
Too many things came together for that.
Collided.
Yeah, in other words, there's a good chance, forgive me, that, you know, other things could happen, you know, but that may not.
Oh, he struggled with it in the shows all the time. He talked about it a lot.
The thing is, he brought it out. He brought it into the open all the time. So that was kind of therapeutic for him too.
Hold on 1 second. Yeah. Go ahead.
I have a question regarding going back to the journal writing. Did you not say that he had to force himself to do this? I mean, obviously it was a pattern every day, but talk a little bit about the actual journal writing, the process.
The one contradiction I think that you're picking up on is that I was talking about how he doesn't write the monologues, right? He does them in performance, but he takes notes and on his days. He writes a lot in the journal, so he has all of this material to go back to. So there's lots of detail that are in the journals.
Which they
translate when he becomes into the spoken story.
Right.
But he definitely is quite religious about writing in his journal.
No, he would write every day. But I think once he had a family, you know, and taking on the responsibility of raising children, he wrote less. Like he'd get up in the morning, he goes, well, really, I just want to play with the kids. You know, on the weekend, he goes, but I know I have to write in the journal a little bit. So you might see like a paragraph on a Saturday or something, you know, but. I think he wrote more when he was younger.
It was writing formal pieces or pieces he was asked to write that he found impossible.
Those were tasks, chores.
But journals he kept constantly, so there was none.
I guess just two things and an observation. No, I think it's funny that you guys are so open to talking about his personal life, just because I was at a Philip Glass workshop, and I really wanted to ask a question about his ex-wife, Candy, who had passed away. But everybody else, they're all like huge music theory nerds, so they were just asking about that. So my observation, just, I thought, you know, the casting of Libby in Rumstick Road, just with that, you know, she just has, there's that part where she's just doing this for like 15 minutes.
How does one do that?
Exactly. And I don't think that, you know, she's like loony in Vermont right now because of that specifically, but I just find it,
know that story,
really poetic and sad that that, I mean, it was such a beautiful part and that she's there now, you know, kind of.
Yeah,
Libby just disappeared afterwards, right?
We actually saw her a year before Spalding died in Vermont.
Yeah. How was that?
I thought she was like okay.
Yeah, she's actually getting. Yeah. Apparently, she's getting along, relatively okay. Yeah. I mean, but she did go through a breakdown.
Yeah.
Oh.
The whole. I mean, this is. It's almost. Forgive me. The whole group is like a serious mental asylum.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, except for Peyton, I think Peyton's okay.
Peyton survived.
Peyton has a restaurant in Arizona.
Right.
She's fine.
She survived, but the early people, all between different you know diseases and suicide or, you know, normal things that happen in life and all wacko.
But wait, what was your question?
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right.
No, no. It's
one thing I wanted to say, when you say we're so open about talking about it, this was the material of Spalding's life.
Exactly. Yeah. I just
and even in his last monologue is after the accident and when he is struggling and he's trying to figure out can he even go forward and what's he's happening and he does have a final monologue that he again is trying to process even what he was doing, what was happening to him. Mm-hmm. After the accident, by performing it, by making it into a story, so you know that is the material from which his work was made.
Yeah, that's a good point, and it really is critical to know that, and because this is extremely kind of open and you know about someone's fairly personal life, but that's what his work was, so it's hard to. It wasn't Phil Glass, it wasn't Baroque or Bach, it was you know something me. Him.
Everybody, yeah, really. I guess it's sort of a self-serving question. sorry, but I had this idea before I found out about interviewing the audience, where I was like, wouldn't it be great if there was just a whole show where it was just interviewing the audience, and then I found out about it, and I was like, damn it, I can't do that. And I don't want to do you know the exact same thing.
And I've given permission to people to do it if you ever want to.
Oh, okay, because that was sort of kind of my question, because I would love to. It just seems really interesting, and I don't think it could ever not be something new if you're just talking to people, because that's the beauty in a conversation, right?
Mm-hmm. Talk to Kath after. Norm has a question.
I just wanted to say, because Kathy hasn't mentioned it, but one of her many enormous accomplishments in the years following Spalding's death was to oversee the publication of an edition of Spalding's journals. So for people who don't know, those are in print. It's a remarkable editing job. I'm sorry, I forget the name of the journalist who...
Eleanor Casey.
I mean, really... brilliant job of kind of editing and distilling and juxtaposing these materials, and they're fascinating reading. So if anyone is interested, that is out there. That and the Soderbergh film, you know, both followed Lucy's performance. Is that the live performance?
Followed the play, right.
The play. Right. So it's, you know, funny, the play in so many ways kind of, you know,
launched the other projects.
Foresaw these enormous projects that would follow.
Yeah. I also found it interesting when we were working on it, but you do find the source material in the journals. You see the things like, oh, that turned into that monologue, that found its way there. So it's an interesting point.
And I'd have to say, of all the projects, there were five projects I did after Spalding died, that was the hardest. Because he didn't publish his journals before. You know, he was very selective about what he took from the journals to make into material. So I was very protective about what I wanted in the book and what I absolutely refused to let them publish. So that was the hardest project. And actually, Lucy was a great advisor on that one. She goes, don't put anything in that's going to make you or the children uncomfortable.
Well, that's the other thing, is you have these kids who are still, you know, living.
So how much of the journals were published. So what was the percentage?
Yeah, it's I think it's like almost 400 pages, I think. But he had over 200 journals, so yeah.
All right. So we got maybe two more questions.
Thank you. First I just wanted to thank you all for sharing this evening with us and your reflections with us. We really appreciate it. As was said, Spalding's, the material of his life was the material of his work, so those of us who only knew him through his work so felt like we knew him extraordinarily well. He seemed to be so open with his work and with his life, his experiences, his difficult experiences. For those of us who just knew him through his work, what aspect of knowing him of what he was like would be surprising to us or didn't come out from your experience in his work?
He was quiet at dinner parties. We'd get all these crazy invitations because everyone thought he'd be the life of the party or the entertainer of the party, and he'd be really quiet. Or as Ken said, when he first met him, he thought he was aloof. I thought he was aloof, too. Yeah.
He had a definitely had a kind of, but that was
New England snobbery.
Yeah, definitely a New England snobbery, a New England classicism.
Or, right.
And you know, quite impressive. And he was a tremendous thinker and, you know, contemplator of life's issues and the ironies there. You know, like that, some of that reading was just wonderful, of the readings you just heard, which just, you know, it's just wonderful. And that's what we thrived on for a while, and he and I and, you know, others near him, just devouring each other's, you know, willingness to just shoot the shit, so to speak. He's an extraordinary human.
Last one from Norm.
Thank you. I just wanted to say, you know, a lot of us only knew Spalding in the Worcester Group years and the years that followed. And even when we saw him acting in a conventional sense in films or on television, he was usually either cast as or himself, kind of built on his Spalding persona that he had developed. But in fact, he was a great actor. And if you look back at the film, several of which exist, of the performance group work predating the Worcester Group, there's a wonderful film of Richard Schechner's production of Sam Shepard's Tooth of Crime. And Spalding just burns up the stage and burns up the film. And you only have to look at it for 10 minutes and you go, who is this guy? And he really, you know, he took his acting and his performing in a certain direction. But if you see these films of him as a young actor that exist, you can see that he could have been, you know, a very great actor in the conventional sense.
No, he was definitely on his way. He finally hooked up with a good agent who was getting him all the, like, who got him on The Nanny as, you know, the therapist. And he was definitely heading that way, I think.
Well, and the what we're going to end with
right.
is a clip of Spalding talking about being in Our Town on Broadway. Greg Mosher directed Our Town on Broadway and asked him to play the stage manager. And I just have to say, it was really wonderful to look. A couple years ago, they were writing about, oh, the great, it got bad reviews, and in particular, the Frank Rich was terrible to Spalding, so he was a terrible stage manager, horrible. And in, you know, a couple years ago, there was this big thing in the Times of, like, choosing your favorite stage manager in Our Town, and several people wrote about, you know, Spalding was the definitive, you know. So it was a nice resurrection of that. But anyway, this is a really fun excerpt from Monster in a Box.
Monster in a Box, that's
I'd like to just...
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. The piece that that Bob referred to is called The Tooth of Crime, and it's interesting because Spalding played a aging rock star who is about to be kind of overthrown by the new rocker, that was my film. I filmed it. No, it's okay. Okay, maybe this is just, he commits suicide at the end.
That's right. I completely forgot that.
Yeah, because he can't do the moves anymore that the new guy can do in the rock business, in the world of music, rock music. End of story.
Well, we will now watch the final clip, Monster in a Box.
But I love doing the play, actually. I did. I was able to get in touch with Thornton Wilder's language, which helped me transcend anything the critics said and swept me away back to New England, where I had originally come from, where I once believed in God and eternity, in all the things that the play talked about before I moved to New York City and became a hardcore Freudian existentialist. And particularly the cemetery scene. You see, Emily dies in childbirth, and they have her funeral on stage in the last act. And I had never been to a funeral before in my life. I'd even missed my mother's funeral because I was trying to take a vacation in Mexico when all of that happened. And now I'm going to a funeral 8 shows a week, Emily's. And strangely enough, this event is giving me a kind of closure around this whole issue with my mother and having missed her funeral. And every night they would bring Emily on and bring her out in white, dressed in white. They would sing a hymn for her, and they would leave and cast her off, and she would walk across stage dressed in white and step into a straight back chair, which represented her grave, surrounded by all the other recent dead, all in their straight back chairs, sitting bolt upright, staring up at the stars above. And there they all were, fully concentrated. The little boy playing Emily's brother, Wally Webb, 11-year-old boy, is sitting there for 40 minutes without blinking while I stand and talk about eternity and say things like, "You know as well as I do that the dead don't stay interested in us living for very long. But they stay here until the earth part of them burns away, burns out. They're waiting. They're waiting for something they feel is coming, something important and great. Aren't they waiting for the eternal part of them to come out clear?" And every night I would say that 8 shows a week, and every night basically it would be the same. But often when you're doing a long run in the theater, often you have what I call a unifying accident, in which something happens so strange on stage that it suddenly unifies the audience and the cast together in the realization that they are only here for this one moment together. It's not a film, it's not television, and because of the nature of the accident, we all know that it probably will never be repeated again in the same way. And somewhere in the middle of the run, that happened. I was talking about the dead, and I said, "They're waiting. They're waiting for something they feel is coming, something important and great." And I turned to gesture to them waiting, and just as I turn, the little 11-year-old boy projectile vomits. Wah! Like a hydrant it comes, hitting one of the dead on the shoulder. The other dead levitate out of their seats in fear and drop back down. The little boy runs from the stage, vomit pouring from his mouth. Splatter, splatter, splatter. I am standing there on the stage. My knees are shaking. The chair is empty. The audience is thunderstruck. There isn't a sound except for one little 10-year-old boy in the 8th row. He knows what he saw. He is laughing. And I simply don't know what to do. I don't know whether to go on with the next line as written and be loyal to Thornton Wilder or attempt what might be one of the most creative improvs in the history of American theater. And then I decide at last to be loyal to Thornton Wilder and simply continue with the next line. And I turn to the empty chair and say, "Aren't they waiting for the eternal part of them to come out clear?"
Very perfect. Thank you so much, Kathy, Lucy, and Ken. Thank you all for coming, that's right, being here. Oh, we will have a little reception, so please hang around and talk with us and to each other.